Thank you. I love what I hear going on in the lobby and in here. Worship is about fellowship with our Maker, our Creator, bringing honor and glory to His name. And the way we treat each other when we come to worship is reflective of what we think of God and what we believe God thinks of us. So when I hear everyone just being warm and friendly and welcoming and telling your stories, it just warms my heart. I know that when we're in the lobby having a really, really good time and there's things going on in here, I know that sometimes we get shushed just a little bit. And I'm not a shusher. Linda tries to help us keep the din down. Because what happens is when we open that side door, it's like a tunnel down the sides. And you can hear actually better up here what's being said out there than you can when you're in the back row. But still, let's remember that it's all about, it's fellowship, it's part of worship, and we're having a good time, but let's also keep in mind that we don't want to disrupt other things that are going on. Well, maybe we do, but let's be respectful of each other, okay? All right? And don't make Linda have to shush you, because then I shush her, and it's not good. And so welcome, everyone. Lord Jesus, thank you. We bless your name. Your goodness is just palpable in this room as we welcome each other into your house. Lord, we will stand, we will sit, we will eat at your table today. Thank you for blessing us with an abundance. Thank you that you prepare a table before us in the presence of the enemy. And you have called us to love our enemies. Lord, we have no idea what that looks like practically. We make up a lot of things. But today we are not in the presence of the enemy. We are in your presence, and we banish all darkness from this place. We call the Holy Spirit and invite him to come and fill this place. Holy Spirit, come and blow through our minds and our hearts. And blow away anything that would come between our hearts and yours. Blow through this room. Fill it. Fill all the nooks and crannies with your Spirit and your holy angels. We pray this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Ain't no rock gonna cry in my place. As long as I'm alive to glorify your holy name, ain't no rock gonna glorify. As long as I'm alive to glorify your holy name, praise your. Gonna shout in my place as long as I'm alive to glorify your holy name. Ain't no voice gonna shout in my place as long as I'm alive to glorify your holy name. Praise your. I'm alive to glorify your holy name. Praise your holy name. I read a story this last week. The man was recounting visiting a farm, an Amish farm, the family he had never met before. And as he drove onto the farm, got out of the car, a very short, stocky man came running towards the car at him, full steam ahead. Farmer Zook was running the farm with his adult children, and the eldest was taking care of the household duties in the kitchen, but three of the others were Down's children, and he had raised them virtually by himself. And the youngest, Elam Zook, went running towards the car where Mr. Manning was getting out. And Mr. Manning says that about 2 feet from him, this short, stocky, bearded man of 40 years old threw himself at him, threw his arms around him, wrapped his legs around his waist. And then the next sentence made me shudder. Elam Zook kissed Mr. Manning on the lips, full on. Now, I want to know what Mr. Manning was thinking in those few seconds. Yes. I mean, just in reading that, I recoiled. I don't like people getting in my space. But Elam Zook threw himself at Mr. Manning. And it appears that Mr. Manning did not recoil. Mr. Manning did not push him away. He did not run away. And within a few seconds, Mr. Manning says, he was suddenly seized by the power of a great affection. He said, God loved me through Elam Zook. And I pray this morning as you worship in the presence of your church family and the presence of the holy angels and the Holy Spirit and God Almighty, that you are seized by the power of a great affection. You are the rock of my salvation. You are the strength of my life. You are my hope and my inspiration. Lord, unto you will I cry. You are the rock of my salvation. You are the strength of my life. You are my hope and my inspiration. Lord, unto you will I cry. I believe. Believe in all God's kids said. Amen. I'd invite you to stand up and greet each other with a handshake or a hug, whatever is appropriate for you. A life story in 15 seconds or less. Welcome, everyone. And prepare for the Lamb's offering as well. I think some of our littles have gone into the side room already. I want to invite the littles to come out and come and collect their butterfly catchers. And the olders will get out your green, quiet, soft money. Oh, good. Alicia's coming. I love that sound. There they come. Get out your green, quiet, soft money. Thank you so much for what you do for Glenview Adventist Academy's special projects. Amazing things have been done because of this offering, and we are so grateful.
Good morning. Morning. Welcome to the Glendale Adventist Church. We have an interesting day going on, so I put a schedule on the screen. 8:30 here, we have Dr. Sweatt to speak for our health rally. At 10 o'clock, there'll be a general lesson study here in the sanctuary. At 11 o'clock, in here is actually Pathfinder Adventurer Sabbath, so we're going to celebrate our kids today. Then we have lunch, and then the health rally will continue at 2 to 5, and tomorrow from noon to 5. So that's the schedule for the day, and we are glad that you are here. We already had some of our things scheduled before we were asked if we could do the health rally. So it's an interesting day. We're glad you've come, and we hope you have a great day. We do have a potluck lunch I mentioned today, and it says something about they're celebrating us being here 27 years. I'm glad you're happy we were here 27 years and not wondering when we'll leave. Stay and have lunch with us, all right? Now, if you're a member, you're supposed to bring food so that our guests have good luck, all right? Our weekly schedule is fairly normal. Both of our Monday afternoon and evening events here, Bible studies at the church, are going. Tuesday night is not happening this week. There will be a Tuesday night, but there won't be a meeting here. We haven't canceled Tuesday night. You can enjoy it. Wednesday, we will have our prayer meeting here. 6 o'clock, we open up the room for just quiet meditation with music and prayer slides, and then we have our worship and prayer time at 6:30. Ladies dine out this week. Sign up in the lobby. That'll be on Monday. There's a youth social event next Sabbath afternoon, 1:30 in the chapel with Pastor Eddie. It's for our older grade school kids, so we hope parents will bring your kids, be involved in that. We have one of the ladies in our church, help one of our helpers with Pathfinders, who's published a book, and she's having a book launching a week from tonight out at Desert Cove, and asked me to ask you to consider coming. So take a look at that. Don't look too long, because we're moving on. Marilyn, you want to talk about this?
We're not going to be using the gym for the brunch or the prayer brunch a week from Sunday. We will be using the chapel, which means that we're more limited in the space. So we're only going to allow about 40 to 45 women to sign up this time, okay? I don't want you to be left out, but I also, we have a great big wedding in the later in that day, and so we're going to be using the chapel. The sign-up sheet is in the lobby at the desk, and please do not forget to sign up. We do, it's short notice, I know, but we do need you to sign up. And again, it's limited space, and we're planning the breakfast for you. And then Erica Watson is going to be our presenter. Did you ever wonder what your spiritual gift was? Come and find out. Erica's going to help us with that. So a week from Sunday at 9 o'clock, 9 to 11:30 in the chapel, and please sign up.
Thank you. On Tuesday night, 23rd, there will be our Glenview Spring Concert, and that's always a great event. That'll be in the gym, and limited seating, I guess, so come early because, yeah, by the time we get it all set up, there's not that much space left. So, but it's a great event, Glenview Spring Concert, Tuesday night. Sign-ups for VBS, I believe, are continuing in the lobby. Don't to miss that. Get your kids registered early. The Pathfinders are inviting you to join them for a Feed Our Starving Children packaging event a week from today at 4 o'clock. You do need to sign up again. Boy, space is limited today. Everything is space is limited. You make reservations for these, and I think they've got like 25 slots. And so if you want to be involved in that, check the lobby county on that counter as well, or give Andrea a call. Also, the Pathfinders have a nice pin you can pick up for $5, which helps support the club. They'd love to have everybody buy and sport those pins. They're already asking if you're interested in helping with Pathfinders next year. We're wrapping up the current year today, and they're going to do some off-season events as well. So just kind of keeping you posted with what's happening there. Our parking lot project, we're making pretty good progress. We need another 33,000 in pledges by next week in order to sign contracts. We will give you a full update next week, but things are looking good. We're hoping to have the parking lot completely resurfaced, removed and resurfaced during camp meeting when there isn't a lot of action going on here. So that's our goal, what we're pressing forward. And I had to put this slide up. They made me do it. So Patty insisted on it.
Well, we want to take a moment to focus on the goodness of God. Amen? How many of you know the story of the 10 lepers in the Bible? Yeah? So how many of them were healed? All 10, yeah. So how many returned to say thank you? One. So we want to be like the one that returned to say thank you to Jesus for his goodness, right? So, again, another question. How many of you here are 27 years old? Would you stand if you're 27? Anybody? Nobody 27. Okay. How many of you have been here at the Glendale Church for 27 years? Would you please stand? Anybody here? 27? It's okay if you've come and gone. That's okay, too. Dixie and George, 27 years. Well, and Pat Gilliland, she's at the door. She's greeting. She's peeking her head in. So on April 1st, we celebrated here at Glendale, Pastor Gary and Marilyn being here for 27 years. Amen? Amen. Amen. So we want to take a moment right now, and we just want to say thank you to God for his goodness of having them be here. Marilyn, would you please come? And we want to just have a prayer. Oh, here, you get the flowers. All right. Would all of you please join me in standing as we offer a word of prayer? Father God, we want to thank you right now for your goodness. Lord, you are so good, and your blessings just flow over us continually, Lord God, day after day. And Lord, right now we want to thank you for blessing the Glendale Church with Pastor Gary and Marilyn for 27 years. And Lord, you called them here, and you've called each one of us here. So we pray, Father, that you will continue to bless this church family, to continue to grow us, to know you better. And we pray, Father God, that we will continue to serve you for as long as you see fit. And I pray, Father God, that you will keep them here until they retire or until Jesus returns. We thank you, Lord God. Continue to fill them with your Holy Spirit. Bless their marriage, bless their health, and bless their ministry, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. We are the ones who have been blessed to have such a great church family. We've outlasted most of the folks that were here when we arrived. But thanks for joining us.
I've never seen that picture before. Somebody should have asked me. I don't usually wear a boa. But that was a big party, wasn't it? It was the Christmas party. That's right. It was the Christmas party. Yeah. That's enough of that, yes. Please check your cell phones. As someone once said, unless it's from God or my mother, it can wait.
Our offering today is for the Hope Channel, one of our Adventist television channels. And so that's a North America-wide ministry, I believe. If you want some of your money to go there, that's a worthy cause. Sure to mark an envelope. All unmarked offerings stay right here for our church budget. Thank you so much for your wonderful support of our church. Let's pray. Jesus, as we return our tithes and offerings today, we are counting on your blessing. You've promised it. You've told us to test you with this, so we're going to do it. Give us generous hearts like yours and pour out your blessing, we pray. Amen.
Been following the devotional that my husband started us on this at the beginning of this year. We've been going through the Sermon on the Mount. And I pray that as you read this, you're not intimidated by it. But that, as I said earlier in the story, that you are seized by the power of a great affection. What God is calling us to is not to just strive and work harder, grit our teeth and love our enemies, but he's calling us back to Eden. He's calling us back to life. He's calling us to love. The power of his love is even greater than Elam Zooks, as I told you in the story earlier. It's even greater than that. And he slung himself at Mr. Manning and kissed him full on the lips. Mr. Manning said he was overcome by the power of a great affection, but it was God's affection that he felt flood through him. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and he taught them. Did you ever wish that God would open his mouth and speak to you? He does. He is. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law and the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to make complete. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you're not going to be able to be part of the kingdom. And he goes on and on and on, and the more he goes on, you think, I can't do this. Love your enemies. Don't commit adultery. You've heard that, but don't even think about it. Don't even entertain the thought. In all the oath taking, just be truthful. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Don't retaliate. Love your enemies. Pray for those who curse you. Therefore, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. And we say, We swallow, and then we look at all the things that he just said, and we start making excuses and start mitigating the language and trying to make it fit into what we know or believe about the reality of ourselves. The truth is that if what we think about God and what God thinks about us is going to reflect on how we treat each other. So it's really important that we come to know what God thinks of us and understand his character of love and passion towards us. Be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. No problem. Jesus took care of that. We live in the reality of what Jesus has already done while we're still being transformed into his likeness. The power of his love, it's a great power to be seized by. It's frightening, but it's a great power. Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed. Stripped away. God's ways are not burdensome. They can be overwhelming in their counterculture and counterintuitive. But the reality is, God's ways are life. It's the very air that we breathe as Holy Spirit in. The word that we put in our hearts and minds every day is bread to our souls. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my day. Spirit, would you pour out your healing power on those who need healing of the heart this morning? Would you cause them to sense you are bumping up against them? My prayer is that each one of us, wherever we are in our relationship with you, that through the power of your love, through your Holy Spirit, that we will fall more deeply in love with you. And that will be reflected in our lives. I pray again, Lord Jesus, that we will be seized by the power of your great affection for us. There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. In Jesus' name and for his sake, may all power and glory and honor be yours. And all God's kids said, amen. Amen. Thank you, Justin and Dennis, for driving so far to come and worship with us today. It's always a pleasure and an honor to have you. Thank you.
So I'm going to invite Uganda to come up and introduce our speaker. And for those of you who are guests here at Glendale for the health rally today, I do want you to know that Dr. Sweatt will also be speaking at 11:10 in the chapel for our guests from out of our church. We're celebrating our Kids and Pathfinder Sabbath here during second service in this room. And it's an interesting juxtaposition of events that happened here. So, but Dr. Sweatt will be speaking at 11:10 in the chapel for our out-of-church guests. Thank you for being here, please.
Happy Sabbath. So if you're here for the health rally and did not receive a folder, can you raise your hand? My sons are going to pass out a folder if you're a guest with us for the health rally. It has the schedule for the weekend. So if you just raise your hand, the boys will pass it out. Thank you, boys. So I'm going to introduce Dr. William Sweatt. He is currently a gastroenterology specialist and has over 27 years of experience in the medical field. He is board certified in gastroenterology and internal medicine and specializes in gastroenterology in Lake Jackson, Texas, where he helped to develop and build a practice and endoscopy center offering clinical, endoscopic, laboratory infusion, and pathology services. In addition, he provides a lifestyle and preventative medicine wellness program for the community, improving general health, specific diseases, and developing cooking and gardening skills.
Morning, church. And happy Sabbath. All right, I wanted to thank this church, the conference, Dr. Woods, the pastor. I don't know where the pastor went, but oh, the pastor's back there. Pastor, I came to the camp meeting this summer and gave some talks there, and I was impressed with your pastor's musical abilities. But, Pastor, your wife might have one-upped you today, brother. And I wanted to thank Elder Keys, your conference president, for being a longtime friend. So let's get started. I have the pointer. Let me see. Is this the pointer? It's the bring button. Okay. If I need to go back, I'll let you know. Okay. So health reform important for reformation and revival. This is our topic for today. Is it important? Let me see. Oh, that's the pointer. So what's the green? Oh, the big green button. Okay. So what is revival for? What is reformation and revival for? It's to prepare us for the work of the harvest. We know that Jesus is coming soon and he expects us to be workers. Jesus says the harvest is ripe, but the workers are few. We have to prepare to be those workers. God wants us to be those lights, those helping hands. You guys are having an adventure day today. Sunbeams, helping hands on earth for the master. God doesn't want to do it by himself. Why? Because if we work with him, we are saved ourselves. You don't get saved by yourself. You get saved with other people. The health message and the final movements. This is sort of Adventist lingo. I think Adventists here know what I'm talking about. The health message and the final movements. Is it mutually exclusive? Is it two different things? Or is it symbiotic? And I say that as a gastroenterologist because symbiosis we will talk about today, because the gut is very symbiotic. Not only with the brain, but also with the microbes in our bodies that are very, very important. This is the text that I was given when they asked me to speak here, Dr. Wilson, to speak. And it says, this is from Ministry of Healing, page 143. The harvest is ready, but the laborers are few. The world needs today what it needed 1900 years ago, a revelation of Christ. Now, I'm a gastroenterologist. I'm going to talk about food and digestion later today. I'm going to put a little bit in this morning, but this morning we're going to uplift Christ. Is that all right? Amen. A revelation of Christ. That's what the world's waiting for. Everybody's looking for love. Gangbangers are looking for love. Why are they in the gang? Because they get love in the gang. The great work of reform is demanded. She says a great work of reform is demanded. For us to reveal Christ, a great work of reform is demanded. And it's only through the grace of Christ, that means the power of God, that the work of restoration, physical, mental, and spiritual, is accomplished. And that's what we're going to talk about today. How do we accomplish that? The physical, that's our bodies, the mental, how our brains work, how we communicate with God, and the spiritual, how do we advance? So what is the health message? I know some of you guys aren't here as Adventists, but we were given a health message back in the 1800s. And the defining work was in Spiritual Gifts, Volume 4. This is 1863. Ellen White, considered her prophet, and she was given this vision of what we should do. And what was she given? Well, she had earlier visions in 1848 that tobacco was bad for you. Now, the AMA, I'm part of the American Medical Association, we didn't tell people smoking was bad for you until the 1950s. Matter of fact, we would actually tell people to smoke for certain lung conditions. And we know now that that was bad, right? So how did a lady with a third grade education know that? How did she know that? Think about that. You should have to think about that. I know tea and coffee is a little bit, you know, that's a little bit of controversy, but that's what she said. In 1850, she said cleanliness. Dr. Lister, you guys heard of Listerine. Well, Dr. Lister was started to espouse we should use clean techniques in surgery. Before that, surgeons, well, I'm an internist, so I can call a surgeon a butcher. But that's what they were. They were butchers, right? We were butchers. They would just go from operating room to operating room without washing their hands. But Ellen White said we should wash our hands. Dr. Kellogg, who was the lead of the medical work for our church in the 1800s, would wash his hands. And guess what? He had the best outcomes. And everybody was going to see Dr. Kellogg. Henry Ford, Carnegie, Lister, all these big names were coming from all over the country, all over the world to see him because of that. But it's not something that she came up with. The Jews did this in Europe. A lot of times the pogroms where Jews were being persecuted was because of cleanliness, because when an epidemic swept through, the Jews survived. They did better than everybody else, so they thought they had some witchcraft or something, and that's the reason why they survived more than other people. But it was because of the Levitical laws and the Bible. So it's a Bible-based health message. Animal fats. We all know doctors now are telling everybody to watch the fats, right? But she was saying watch that way back then in 1850. Also, the health message is taking us all over the world now. We're everywhere, spectacle to the world. The Blue Zones, this is a guy named Dan Buckner. And the Adventist Church and the people here live longer than other people. This is why we're talking about a health fair today. We're going to share what we know with other people. You don't keep it to yourself, you share this message of health. And what we found is the Adventists live longer, 7 to 10 years longer, and they have a better quality of life. They're still pumping their gas, cutting their grass, going to the mall, buying stuff for the grandkids, the great-grandkids, the great-great-grandkids, until their 90s into 100s. So the health message has two main purposes, an outer purpose and an inner purpose. We all know the outer purpose. It's the entering wedge. For us that are Adventists, it's the entering wedge. It allows us to go places that we would not be able to go otherwise. When people see that you know something about health, they say, well, maybe they know something about this other stuff. They say, is that in the Bible? They say, yeah, cleanliness is in the Bible. And that's why you can live. And this is in the Bible. And they say, oh, really? And they want to hear what else you have to say. But there's also an inner work, and that's for us. And if we don't do this inner work, how can we reveal Christ? Think about it. We all have to have this inner work. People just, you know, some people just get on your nerves, right? I know I get on some people's nerves. You know why? Because they're seeing me and they're not seeing Christ, right? That's the bottom line. So the health message in its simplest form is something we call New Start. And this is an acronym. You see all these names like N-E-W go down. It says New Start, right? But there's also some other things that Ellen White talked about, and that's we should be cheerful. To win people, you have to be winsome. And that's one thing I always admired your elder here, Elder Keys, for. He was always cheerful. And that might be part of the reason why I joined the church with him. But, and also willpower. We have to choose. We have to choose. God gave us that ability. That's our frontal lobe. He allows us to choose. So health reform is actually applying the health message in your life. And what's the purpose? To go from physical to mental to spiritual. And as you guys who understand the sanctuary know, that when you walk into the sanctuary, the pillars are set up. The base of the pillars are always brass. That's physical. That's earthly. That's us, like Adam. And then you go to the top, and the tops are always silver or gold. And I guess that would be mental or spiritual. So let's pray. That's one thing I got to pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning asking for your grace, for your help, dear Lord. Send your Holy Spirit to help us. Help us to understand. We know that you're coming soon. We know that we need to change. We know we need to be transformed so that we can reveal you to the world. They shouldn't see us. They shouldn't see our faults, our idiosyncrasies, but the one altogether lovely, that they can fall in love with you. We might be the only Jesus they see. Help us to prepare, we pray thee. Help us, dear Lord, we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. So, a great work many times starts with health. Dr. Wood called me up and I said, a great work many times always starts with health. And you know, the Bible tells us that. If we would look carefully, the God has been telling us all along. Joey, eat your vegetables. Is that told because of love or hate? The parent wants the best for the child. 3 John 1:2, you guys know this verse well. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. With this written by the beloved disciple, I would submit to you that the health message is a message of love, a message being verified by medical science, which we'll talk about this afternoon if you want to come back. But sometimes love's not easy. How many of y'all know that? Everybody, I think the older people here know that. Young people, y'all might not know that yet, but you're going to find out. Sometimes love is not easy. This is our text for today, Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. This is one of my favorite texts when I first joined the church with Elder Keys. I used to love this text. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. The Lord has to reason with us. He's got to reach our mind. It's the only way he can reach us. And that's what we're going to talk about. I'm going to start where I left off on the gut-brain connection at the camp meeting, and that's at this place. It's Victor Valley Medium Community Correctional Facility. This is an amazing story of the health message and an example of how we can overcome as well. Reformation. Where's the number one reformational facilities in America? It's the prisons. Amen? It's the prisons. When you go to prison, they say, if you get out, they say, you're reformed, right? You are reformed. They don't let you out unless you're reformed. If you're going to go out and do something bad again, they should keep you in there, right? Everybody wants to stay in there. What can we learn from this place? Well, let me give you a summary of what I'm going to say, and I gotta get running because I got to get through with this by 10 o'clock. So if I go fast, you just have to catch me later. I'll go through stuff slow with you. So I'm gonna tell you what I'm gonna tell you, and then tell you at the end. All right. So real world modern day example of how health reform is a key component of Reformation revival. That's Victor Valley. Doulos. Those that are the pastors, theologians in here know what that means. But you gotta go lower to go higher in this game. If you wanna play in this game and you wanna be one of God's helping hands at the end of time, you gotta go lower. Subclinical states, a cloudy, a terrible state of mind. And then one of my nurses told me, Dr. Sweatt, you're talking about being cloudy. I said, yes, that's a good idea. Thank you, Aaron. And then Bible examples of how health reform is a key component of Reformation and revival. So this, I saw this slide first at ASI in 2017 in Houston by a guy named Ron Duffield, who many of you know. And when he put the slide up, I just took a picture because I was impressed. But little did I know that it would be important for my field later on. There was a 500 inmate prison. They chose New Start, which is what I showed you, a vegan diet, occupational training, Bible studies, anger management classes. 85% of the inmates chose to go vegan, or did the whole health reform. The recidivism rate in California is 95%. The national average is 52%. So California is one of the worst states in the country for people going back to jail. After this program was over, it went from 95% to 2%. What do you think of that? Terry Mullen is a man, he runs Maranatha Mission, and he won the contract, right? He operated this place for 7 years, 85% with this. That on the health reform side of the prison, where they did all those things, there was no fights, racial tolerance, you know, because in prison, everybody has to protect themselves. If I was in prison, I'd be part of the black gang. If one of you got, one of somebody else out there, be part of the white gang. The Mexicans would be part of the Mexican. We have to protect ourselves, otherwise, they might kill you. But there was none of that stuff on the health reform. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. Amen. On the regular side, they still had the gang atmosphere and racial tension. So if you count this stuff up, you take 85% of the prisoners, that's 425 prisoners. Only 8.5 prisoners went back. You know what's going to happen? That prison's going to go out of business. We could put the prison system out of business. If we did this right, praise the Lord. But we'll definitely have one of the best prison ministries ever if we would do this. And what did he do? He gave him not the standard American diet, the SAD diet. He gave him a total vegetarian. They call it vegan, but it's total vegetarian because we're not tree huggers, right? We believe in Jesus. So a vegan diet, they have Bible studies. Oh, Jesus, what do you know? You think he can change your life? An Ethiopian can't change his color. A leper can't change his spots. But Jesus can. Amen. Occupational training, teach a man how to fish. And you give him anger management classes because these guys are street guys, you know? They take care of business to the point where they'll kill each other to do it. So they have to have anger management classes so that they get on the job, they don't lose a job. All right? So, and they were highly successful. Only 2% went back. These are the laws. So which ones are they doing? In prison, you exercise. In prison, you get water. In prison, you get sunshine. You got to go outside and exercise. You get temperance. You get forced temperance, right? You can't do drugs in prison. And then you get air. You're outside exercising. And you get rest. The other two, they weren't getting. The nutrition, they were getting the standard American diet. And they weren't getting trust in God. So what did Terry Moreland offer them was this whole package, but he added nutrition. And he added trust in God. Can't we do that? Hope. Trust in God. These prisoners knew they were hopeless or near hopeless, locked in a culture of failure, recidivism rate of 95%. I mean, even they talk about it in the rap songs, right? I don't know if I'm going to live to be 24, is what these rappers say. They don't know. They don't know. But they got something better. They got hope in Jesus. 1 Corinthians 13:13 says, now abide a faith, hope, and love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. Did they find love? They found it later. They found love later. Did they find faith? Faith is what? The evidence. They didn't have any evidence. So what did they have to start with? They had to start with hope. They had to start with hope. I always wondered, I said, what about this? Faith, you know, gold is the faith and love, but what about hope? If you got nothing, you don't know about Jesus, you got to have something. And Terry offered them hope. That's what Terry offered them. So if you look in the dictionary, it says it's an expectation or desire for a certain thing or to happen, a feeling of trust. And where do we find that in the health reform? Right there at the bottom, trust. God wants you to have hope. If you don't have hope, if you don't have somewhere to start, God wants to give you a place. He's like, listen, if you would just listen to me, just reason with me, and I'll give you a good end. It's a belief that Jesus Christ, his way, his plan, can save you and result in a better life now and eternally. A recidivism rate dropping from 95 to 2% is indeed a miracle of God. God's got a miracle for you. God's got a miracle for me. If we would just listen, he wants to make us the best we can be, because you start with the physical. We are humans. Elijah ran away from that woman. He just went to the top of the mountain, fire came down from God, and then this woman starts to threaten him, he runs away. We're human. We're flesh. We have to deal with this flesh. And that's what God is trying to tell us. For God says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I'm sending this message to you. Please listen. Isaiah 55. For I know the thoughts that I have towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you an expected end. Now, that means a great plan. He's got a great plan for each of us. Listen, I didn't grow up Seventh-day Adventist. I came to church with your elder right here. And the Lord took me upon the high places of the earth. I'm going to tell you, those trade towers that went down, I've worked in those places from little old Texas. The Lord took me there. He took me on a mission trip to Africa. I had no money to go. And just because I was following the Lord, he took me there. I'm telling you, this, the God is real. Look what these inmates, a lot of these guys. Now, I met the guy, one of the guys who ran this program. I met him. He's 90-something years old. And he said many of these guys became devoted followers of Jesus Christ. Amen. Look what these guys did. Starting with 15 Bibles. I sat in his house and he told me this. And he can come here. If you want him, he'll come here and tell you this himself. He said they started with 15 Bible studies, 15 prisoners. 6 months, there was 18,000 Bible studies. You know, Ellen White says that this stuff is going to go across like a brush fire. It's like going across that fire that went across Australia. It's going to go across like that. This guy told me that these prisoners worked the gospel like they worked the streets. They didn't pass anybody up. They had to make a sale. If you don't make a sale, you don't eat. You don't get that nice Bugatti you've been wanting. You know what I mean? So where is our hope? Do we even know that we need hope? I said, I already got faith and love. Do I need hope? Well, the problem is we don't know who we are. We got to get out of spiritual jail, y'all. Because we got some pet sins, and our recidivism rate has got to be at least 95%. Am I telling a lie? I got a pet sin, you know, everybody's got pet sins. And sometimes they're hard, but you know what? We got to get on our knees and ask God, and I'm going to show you how in a minute, how that works. Actually, this is it, right here. This is it. You got to go slower. You got to go lower. You know, the cross was like this. You know, I'm the, both sides of my family, my mother's side and my father's side, I'm the descendants of African Americans. You know what that means, right? We were slaves. It's not a proud thing, is it? A lot of people disown it. Even the Jews, they say, oh, we've never been slaves. And they tell Jesus that, oh, we've never been slaves. And I had a friend who's not a, he's not a, a per se Christian, but he's a very intelligent person. He says, you know, when I studied this, the Jews and their theology say that they've never been slaves. Did you know that? They say that they were oppressed people, but they've never been slaves. Why? Because of spiritual pride. But pride cometh before a fall, and now they're not the Jews. I won't even get into that whole thing right there. Pride comes before a fall, right? Pride comes before a fall. Doulos. Are you a doulos? Paul said he's a doulos. Did you know that? There's modern day slavery, human trafficking. We all know about that. Modern day human sex trafficking. You know, I have a friend who works for an NGO, one of these Seventh-day Adventist organizations, non-governmental organizations, and she told me, she said, you know, she was just over there in Africa, and she said it made her cry because she talks to people, and some of these people are being sold into the Middle East, Africa for 5,000, Asia, you can just go to Asia and get somebody and buy them for 15,000, and they're slaves. Sometimes they don't know that they're going to be a slave, but they go over there, they never go home. The spirit of prophecy speaks about slavery in our times. Right now, you would never think that'd be possible, right? Slavery is something of the past, but it's here. It's here. It's here. You know, I talked to the guy who helped with the program at Victor Valley. He said that in California, prisoners are considered owned by the state of California. If they want to move you here, they move you here. You can't smoke dope. You can't smoke weed. You can't do this. You can't do that. You got to do what they say. You are owned by the state, right? So we have spiritual slavery. We've been slaves since the Garden of Eden, according to the Bible. So the flesh and the spirit come together, they make a soul, right? And we're condemned because we were acting, we're thinking it, and we're doing it. Romans says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourself servants, or doulos, the word actually is doulos. You know what doulos, so the word, it should say, know ye not to whom ye yield yourself slaves, ye are to whom ye obey, whether to sin or to death, or the obedience unto righteous. Paul said, oh, weak, oh, wretched man that I am. We all know that verse. It's not me, but Paul says, it's not me that does it anymore. I've chosen to follow Jesus. It's sin in me. You have to surrender, y'all. If you're a slave, you do whatever the master says. Otherwise, the master has the right to beat you or to kill you. Right? That's what it is. So it's not I, but Christ. It's not I, but Christ. I'm doing, you know what, Jesus? I surrender to you. I want to do what you say. We have to get on knees and pray earnestly for this, y'all. Seriously. Because otherwise you're a slave to sin, which means you're a slave to the devil. And you know he wants to kill you. The Bible tells us plainly in John 10:10, he came to kill, steal, and destroy. That brother is a mafia. It's a mafioso. Angel is what he is. We can't play with him. We got to go to Jesus. And this is us. The earth is locked up in this sin. But Paul says, hey, I'm a bondservant, I'm a doulos. Paul says, I'm a slave. Called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. Are you a slave? Paul says he's a slave. Paul also says he's a prisoner. So like I said, slaves and prisoners have sort of a dual similarities there. But it was translated prison. But this is in the book in the Bible, which is about slavery. Philemon is a slavery book. Paul says, hey, Philemon, don't treat this slave, Onesimus, like a slave. He's your brother. If he's part of this church, he's your brother. Put that stuff down. If you don't treat him like you treat me, I have nothing to do with you, you know? And what are the other apostles? The other apostles say that they're slaves. James said it. Peter said it. Jude said it. John said it. The beloved disciple John said, I'm a slave. I'm a slave to Christ because I'm not in charge. The master. We call Jesus the master, right? The master's in charge. Jesus, take the wheel. That's what they say at my office. When the staff member would say, Jesus, take the wheel. Jesus, take the wheel. This is what Ellen White said. We have to get on our knees and ask God, please, please, take the wheel. You're in charge. You're the master. I don't want Satan to be my master anymore. And I'm saying this, and I know it's theoretical, but we got to believe Jesus is more powerful than the devil, y'all. It's time. It is time. Jesus came to set the captives free. When he started his ministry, he stood up in the synagogue and he said, I've come to set the captives free. And he was quoting from Isaiah 61. 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. God wants to set us free. If you become Jesus' slave, he sets you free. What does it say? And they shall call his name Jesus, and he shall save them from their sins, from their slavery to sin, the jailhouse. Right there. But Jesus goes one step even further, and Jesus says, behold, what manner of love that we should be called. Jesus makes us family. And joint heirs with Christ. You know what joint heirs with Christ means? I mean, all the stuff that we're grabbing and stuff, I want to get this, I want to get that, I want to get this, I got to get that. But if we, it's just like he took Abraham outside. He see the stars of the sky, Abraham? That's how many kids you're going to have, right? I would tell you today, you see the stars out there? Those are yours. We're joint heirs with Christ. Those stars are ours. We get to sit on the, Revelation 3:21 says, we sit on the throne with Jesus, our brother and our father and our God. That's amazing, don't you think? Amen. When we go out at night, think about that. Look at those stars and say, my God, that's mine? Jesus is telling you, that's yours. One thing you got to do is get this right. Don't pass up Jesus. Lord, help me. I'm going to be honest. I'm still sinning too. But I got to get on my knees and ask Jesus to help me. And this is one way we got to realize that we're slaves. And we got to go low. Jesus did it. Jesus left heaven. He was the king of heaven. He came down here and he became a poor man, right? The poorest of the poor. In a bad part of town. He was in Compton, okay? He was straight up, straight out of Compton. That's where he was. He said, can anything good come out of Compton? That's what he said, Jesus. Anything good come out of Nazareth? Jesus was a brother from Compton. That's what he was. That's what the other people thought about him. He said, how do you know all these things? You're from Compton. You know, a lot of miseducation goes on in Compton, right? They're not great schools. So how do you know so much, Jesus? Think about it. You better study your Bible like he did. This is the crux of what I want to say. So, major part of the talk. And I think we ought to pay attention here. This is a part of the Bible we all know well. It's Mary Magdalene, and she's coming to anoint Jesus' feet. And Simon looks at Jesus as Mary's sort of wiping his feet and crying. And he's thinking in his mind, if he knew who this girl was, he wouldn't touch her. He wouldn't have her touching him. Right? And so Jesus says to Simon, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And Simon said, Master, say on, Master. And he says, the creditor has two debtors. One owes 50 pence, another owes 500 pence. Which of them will love him most if he's forgiven? Neither one of them can pay. You ever had that? You ever go like this? Right? You don't have no money? I've been like that before. You don't have any money. You have no way you can pay this debt back. And he forgives both of them. Who loves him most? And Simon says, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And Jesus says, there you go, Simon. You have judged rightly. And that's the Lord telling him that. So you know it was true, right? We have to put ourselves in Simon's place. Simon went on to become one of Jesus' best disciples. He loved Jesus more. He was ardent. He adored Jesus. You know why he adored Jesus? Because Simon, it is said, led Mary Magdalene into that sin. And he was a family member at that too. Incest. Can you believe all that? That's bad stuff going on in the Bible. Jesus didn't tell everybody, Simon, you're a big sinner. But he touched his heart. Like he's trying to touch our hearts. Simon and the Pharisees had a misplaced hope. They were trying to avoid the leftists. That's why Daniel had to go to Babylon, right? They had mixed up with these Canaanites and started doing worship like the Canaanites were doing it and all that stuff. Cheap grace. So they came back and said, we're not doing that anymore. We're going to make sure we're not doing it. We're going to tire this way. We're going to do this. And so they had a fastidious adherence to the laws. But they were doing it without God. Are you keeping the Sabbath without God? Are you getting on your knees and asking God for forgiveness? Like you're in the temple, and the one guy's praying, throwing his money into and the other guy's just beating his heart, put his head down, Lord, forgive me, a sinner. That's the difference, y'all. So Simon and the Pharisees didn't realize that they were sin sick and needed a Messiah to save them and everybody else from sin. And if they were saved, they all would be free, and there would be no more oppression, right? The only reason there's oppression is because of sin, because I want this and I want that. You don't realize you own half, the stars in the sky. You wouldn't have to be grabbing for it. But the guys at Victor Valley, they realized their sin-sick condition, and their society reinforced it daily, right? And those guys accepted the help. Their hope was in God and his plan of salvation. So 1 Timothy said, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Are you chief? Are you a chief sinner? I am. Because I understand this. I've got to place myself in that position. I am chief of sinners. Compared to, I mean, Hitler's a lot worse sinner than me, right? But compared to God, what did Jeremiah say when he saw God? Oh, what did Daniel say when he saw God? Oh, I'm a man of unclean lips. Because compared to Daniel or Jeremiah and me or Hitler, compared to Jesus, he's infinitely more pure than we ever thought about it. So what's the difference between all of us, any human, compared to infinity? So every sin to God is bad. If you don't believe it, an apple got us into all this trouble, right? So little sins are big to God. Key to getting out of jail, we got to realize that we're in spiritual jail, a slave to sin, and need to get out. We got to realize that the price is too great for us ever to pay. We can't pay this price. We're in jail. The price to get out is the human blood of God. That's Jesus' blood. It's truly a miracle of love and a mystery of all mysteries. How could the God, you know, Isaiah 40 says that the universe is a tent for God, and there's at least 140 billion galaxies out there, and he compresses himself down to one little human. That's like a nano, that's like beyond super nano nanoparticle. That is unbelievable. So have we appreciated and received this great gift? Do we truly realize our spiritual state, the infinite price that we owe, the 50 pence that Jesus was talking about? Do we love him most, like the Victor Valley prisoners did? We have to reason with God. God is calling us to reason with him. But we got to get this mind together. How do we get this mind together? The mind doesn't work by itself. Think about it. Can the mind feed itself? No. Can the mind walk to the water? No. Think about it. Can the mind hear where the sound of whatever you want to get to? No. Can't do all that. Can't see the food. And if you're like me, because some people can come to Jesus and be touched. But sometimes I'm a little hard-headed. My heart's a little hard. Maybe because I grew up on the wrong side of the tracks. I don't know what it is, but I'm a little hard-headed sometimes. And it doesn't touch me like it touches some other people. And this is where this clearness of thought comes in. Sometimes we have a cloudy mind. I think my mind is clouded up with the world, I think. Enhanced by health reform, the frontal lobe, our communication device. I was going to show you a picture of like Star Trek over the Earth, and you can say, beam me up, Scotty. Or our communication device for Jesus to beam us up, because you know we're going to get beamed up one day, right? We're going to get beamed up. Our communication device is this frontal lobe. This is how you worship God, right here. This is how you decide what's right or wrong. Phineas Gage was a guy who was working on railroad tracks in New England, and the spike went through his brain, and he lost his frontal lobe. He had no morality whatsoever. Look him up. Phineas Gage is a famous story. But that's our site of morality and worship. So we're back to the eight laws. We're going from physical to mental to spiritual. I'm going to speed up. So what are these subclinical states? Well, how can we have a cloudy mind? So the eight doctors all are important. God has to reason with us, but how can he do that when we're asleep? You know the Bible says we're asleep, right? The 10 virgins, you heard that parable, the 10 virgins? All right, we're going to get to that. But God wants to wake us up. Isaiah 61:3, that's our objective. Arise and shine. That's what God wants us to do, to arise and shine. So a subclinical state is a condition that is not severe enough to cause definite symptoms, not detectable or producing effects detectable by the usual clinical test. You need a different test. So some clinical states are like hypothyroidism or diabetes, and I'm going to rush through these because I'm running out of time. Hepatic encephalopathy, that's something that I take care of as a gastroenterologist. What that is your liver doesn't work right, and you eat certain food, and it gets worse. It gets worse, in this case, with animal-type proteins. It's better on plant-based proteins, right? But it can be so slight, it's hard to detect it. So see, zero is minimal, very hard to detect, changes in memory, concentration, intellectual function, coordination, mild to short attention span, mood changes, irritability. Like, he's so irritable like that. I don't know what it is. It could be because his liver's bad, right? And he can't process his food, because when you eat, all your food leaves your stomach, goes in your intestines, and it goes over to your liver to make sure there's no toxins there before it goes out to the rest of your body, right? Process it. And you go all the way down to the place where you're like in a comatose state, and then some people die from this. So, back to the law. So, but you can get in a clinical stupor state for many reasons. You could have it from hepatic encephalopathy due to nutrition. You could have it because you have a bad liver, and bad nutrition leads to the alcohol. You're intemperate, and that leads your mind to being in a state. Have you ever tried to reason with an alcoholic? That's very difficult sometimes, correct? Sleep deprived. If you're sleep deprived, your brain doesn't work really well. And if you're dehydrated, sometimes people get dehydrated. What is dehydration? I'm talking about serious dehydration where your sodium goes from a normal of 140 to like 160, right? 170. You can't think right. Your nerves don't work. Your nerves run by electricity, but electricity works by sodium-potassium channels. And you can ask the doctors here about that, and they'll tell you all about that. But you can also have a spiritual stupor state where you're asleep. The 10 virgins were all asleep, the wise and the foolish. They're both asleep. What does that mean? Well, you could have us dead in trespasses. The Bible is clear in Ephesians and Colossians that we're dead in trespasses. What does that mean? We're like walking around zombies. That's basically what we are. We're walking around zombies. You can only be alive in Christ because this is just a probationary time on this planet. Jesus has given us time to choose between him and Satan. Who's your boyfriend? Is it Jesus or is it Satan? And yes, you have to make that choice. And if you don't make a choice, then Satan's going to take you. Jesus will never do that. He's a gentleman. But Satan will come over and snatch you. You know what that means? If you're a girl? Like certain movies where the guys, if they want a woman, they go grab her. Well, that's what Satan will do. He will grab the woman and take him with her. Whereas Jesus would never do that. He's a gentleman. So we're told in the spirit of prophecy that selfishness is spiritual sleep. And I'm glad you guys are here. Sabbath school is very important. I love Sabbath school, and it talks about that. Love versus selfishness. Jesus is love. Satan is selfish, right? It says in Isaiah and Ezekiel, I shall arise. I will be like the Most High. I will sit in the sides of the north. He had an I problem, a selfish problem. And we do too. And we got to go to Jesus, right? So our great need of God's help. I'm running out of time here. So the forebrain is to work optimally for us to have the best ability to communicate and reason with the Lord. The brain and the body are mutually dependent upon each other. The gut is what I take care of. The second brain. And actually now they're saying it is the first brain, I want you to know. But we're going to get to that later today. And the brain have a special relationship that has now been elucidated with by medical science, but has been in the Bible all along. All along. Jesus knew this before we did as doctors and scientists. But sin is deceitful and blinds us to our own condition. We don't know how bad sin is because sin, by its very nature, blinds us, we're told in the spirit of prophecy. So by the foolishness of preaching, which you're going to hear today, praise God, the word read and applied, the appreciation of God's character and the workings in our lives and his spirit, we are awakened in our minds. And health reform helps us for our minds to be sensitive to the Lord, to awaken. God has to touch our minds, the forebrain, the center of our worship, the center of our communication with God to reach our hearts. Remember in Proverbs 26, it says, son, give me your heart. That's what God's saying. Give me your heart. How are you going to do that? And this is the verse that sort of ties it together for me as a gastroenterologist. But whoso hath this world's good, and seeth his brother have need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion, from him how dwelleth the love of God in him. What are they talking about? How do you have compassion? And is this some term that they use in the ancient world that we don't use anymore? Or is there some physiology about this? We're finding out now that there's physiology that shows that what Paul was saying is something that we understand now. Most of the serotonin, you know, a lot of people take serotonin reuptake, and some of you guys might be taking some serotonin reuptake inhibitors and other medicines that boost your serotonin. Why do we need that? You thought about that? Does serotonin have something to do with love? Yes, it does. Yes, it does. I'm going to talk about that today. So much so that billions are being spent to develop new microbiome centers in major universities like Stanford, UCLA, Harvard, Duke, Emory, University of Chicago, and the list goes on and on. Because the gut has the most intimate and intricate connection and influence on brain function. And we're going to show that this afternoon. Researchers find that many brain and psychiatric disorders can be helped by manipulation of the microbiome. I can make a special little bug to treat your depression. Did you know that? That's what they're developing now. Whatever your condition, I can make a little microbe and treat you with that. A great work. Many times starts with health. I'm never going to go into our Bible session. I'm going to race through this. You guys know. I'm assuming you guys are Bible scholars and y'all know this. So Daniel, think about it. Why did God start with the first chapter on health reform? This is the first clinical trial recorded that we know of. 10-day trial. You know, a lot of churches are doing this 10-day Daniel fast, right? He said, Daniel said, please just give me 10 days. Let's see if God's way or the king's way is better. And we know what happened. They were 10 times better. Why did God make that the first chapter? Because of that great work. He had to reverse everything. He had to make up for everything Hezekiah got wrong. Now, Hezekiah was a great king. But when the Babylonians came to Israel, when the sun went back, he didn't give God the glory. Daniel had many times to take the glory to himself. Did he ever do that? No. He gave the glory to God. We have to give the glory to God. I got to give the glory to God today. This sister up here that's singing so beautifully, she has to give the glory to God. Your pastor who plays so well, he has to give the glory to God. He can't take it to himself. It's God's glory. God gave him that talent. Amen? Elijah, another great work that had to be done. You know what he had to do? He went up there and said, it's not going to rain for 3 years, Ahab. Ahab wasn't mad yet, that mad. But when he couldn't get any water, he was looking for Elijah. He was going to kill him, right? What happened? He went to Cherith, the brook Cherith, and the ravens brought him what? Bread and meat. And then he had to go to Zarephath, to the widow's house, right? What did he eat in Zarephath? That's what it says here in Kings 17. For thus saith the Lord God Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail until the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. Health reform. He was close to God. He trusted God. He did all the other eight or the other seven, but he had his diet had changed too. What happened after that? He went to Mount Carmel, y'all, for a great work. It's one of the greatest scenes in the Bible that we all know. And then John the Baptist, second Elijah. And this John, the raiment of camel's hair and leather girdle about his loins and his meat with locusts and hot wild honey. Who's the third Elijah? Huh?
Us.
Yeah, we are the third Elijah. Do you think that we have a health reform message that God has for us? Amen. Listen, I'm not here to tell you how to run your health reform, okay? But it's time for us to get on our knees and ask God, you know, what I need from my physiology is going to be different than yours. I might be allergic to foods that you love that might help you. You know, Ellen White says, you know, you could be a vegan eating sugar. Did you know that? But you know what Ellen White says? Meat is better than eating all that sugar. That's what she says. That's what she said. Look it up. I'll show it to you later today or tomorrow, maybe it's tomorrow's the sugar. The sugar talk. I'm with my sugar talk. I'll show you if she says that. So you can be vegan eating Oreos, but you're not going to be healthy. All right. So it's the third Elijah. That's what we're going to do. But we need to pray, y'all. Seriously, we need to ask. Each of us has to ask God what God wants us to do. Because it's time. You know it's time. Exodus 15. And when the Israel saw it, they said to one another, "Is manna? For we wist not what it is, what it was." It's like a whatchamacallit. You know, like those I used to eat those candy bars when I was a kid. Whatchamacallit. Whatchamacallit, another name for that is manna. If you translate manna, it means whatchamacallit. I mean, anyway. And Moses said unto them, "This is the bread which the Lord has given you to eat." When did God give him that manna? Huh? Anybody know? When did God give him that manna? Was it after Belpeor? Was it after Nadab and Abihu got zapped? Was it after, when was it? Anybody know? Huh? Yeah. It was the first thing God did. After they crossed that Red Sea, hallelujah. Maria was up there, Miriam was up there singing that song, playing that tambourine. You know what happened the next day? They got some manna. Why did God do it that early on? Do you think it was important in God's mind? You know, God doesn't do anything by mistake. Why did he do that? Why does Daniel, the first chapter, health reform? Why is Elijah doing this? God, when the Israelites, because we all want to be delivered, amen? We all want to be delivered. I want to be delivered. I want to rise up one day. I think I can see Jesus come and go up, like float up, like we're supposed to, like we're told, right? I want to be delivered. God gave him that manna for a reason. First, because we're flesh, y'all. We're flesh. We're not spirit. We're not angels. We're flesh. So we have to deal with our flesh. So God is like, hey, I got to get this. The gut has got to support the brain. It's got to send that serotonin. Why is everybody taking Paxil and Zoloft? To get their mind right, to get feeling right, to feel happy inside, right? Dopamine is like cocaine, crack, sex, whatever. You just get it. But you know what? You got to go back every time, and you got to get a bigger hit. You got to get a more crazier experience, a bigger drug to get that hit. Serotonin, you get the hit, and you feel satisfied. Isn't that strange? You know what the biggest source of serotonin is? The gut. Why is that? Think about it. And if your gut's messed up, which we're going to talk about at 11 o'clock, if your gut's messed up, then maybe your serotonin's low and you've got to take some pills, like some Paxil or something, to get it back up. So the two main purposes, I'm going to wrap it up here. The two main purposes of the health message are the inner awareness to reach the world, and the inner awareness to help reach our hearts and prepare us to reflect His glory to reach the world. So in summary, I'm going to tell you what I told you. So real world, modern day example of how health reform is a key component of Reformation revival, the Victor Valley Correctional Institution. It is possible to escape from our high recidivism rate and be free in Jesus. Jesus will set us free. But we got to get serious about understanding where we are. Doulos, we have to go lower to go higher. The first shall become last and the last first. Didn't Jesus say that? The price to get out of this slavery to sin is too high for us to pay. In fact, we have to go to the third heaven. You know, Paul talked about the third heaven. You know what that means, right? If you don't know, the heaven is like the atmosphere around. The second heaven is all these galaxies, and the third heaven where God lives. We have to go to the third. Can you get a rocket ship and go to the third heaven? I don't think so. To get your ticket out of jail? No, you can't do that. So do we love Him most, like Mary Magdalene? You know, before Jesus went to heaven, He stopped for one person. He didn't stop for James, John, or Paul. He stopped for one person, and that was Mary Magdalene. Why did He stop for her? Why did He stop for her? Because God is love. And He felt that love. You ever feel that love from somebody? Don't you wait? Would you stop too? If you felt that from that person, you'd be like, I'm going to stop. I'm going to go make a special trip to go see this person because I can feel that love. That's what I came back for. That's what I sacrificed everything for. Mary, don't touch me. I haven't gone to my father, but I want to let you know I love you very much. And tell the boys, I'll be back. And in subclinical states, we need to awaken out of our physiological and spiritual slumber of health by health reform, optimize our brains to hear God's voice, to be quickened by His Spirit in our hearts. You know, it says Adam was the first Adam, was flesh, but Jesus is the second Adam, a quickening spirit. He's come to quicken us. That means He's come. You just got to ask Him. Let's get on our knees and ask Him, God, help us. You're coming soon. This world's going crazy, don't you think? It's crazy. We know it's coming soon. The biblical examples of how health reform is a key component of Reformation of Ireland. The road has been traveled before us, y'all. We got it in the Bible, like I said. Daniel, Elijah, John the Baptist, Moses delivering the kids of Israel, right? And they made mistakes. Is being a vegan going to save you? No. Did health reform help those? The mistake that the Israelites made when they came out of Israel was what? They said, Moses, oh, we can't talk to God. You talk to God, and we'll listen to whatever you have to say. But what did God say? God said, Moses, strike the rock. And so He struck the rock, and the water came out. Then He said, Moses, speak to the rock. And what did Moses do? He did what? He struck the rock. Did God tell him to strike the rock? Why did God? That's why Moses didn't go to the promised land. You know that? That's why Moses did not go to the promised land. Why did God think that was so important that He had to spank Moses like that to let him die? Because we're supposed to talk to God. We talk to Jesus. You don't have to die no more. Jesus is upstairs. He's shedding His blood for you right now. We've got to pray to Jesus. We've got to believe that He's our personal Savior right at the right hand of the Father. He can get us saved. He's got the power. Let us learn these lessons. And how does it work? It works by Romans 5:5. The hope. Remember we started with hope? And make us not ashamed because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. When Jesus died on Calvary, He made it possible for the Holy Ghost to shed his love in our hearts. It says in John 17, Jesus wants the same love that was between the Father and him to be in us. But we got to ask for it, y'all. Ellen White says that's the best gift. She says the Holy Spirit is the best gift because it's this. This is one and the same. When you ask for the Holy Ghost, you get this love. This is the power of the church. This was the power of the early church. They couldn't stop us. They were killing us right and left, but it just brought up more and more people because they saw how we, they said, you saw it in the Sabbath school lesson last week. Because of the love, they said, these people love each other. These people love each other. We can trust Jesus. He's going to take us home. Amen. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's all stand and pray. Let's ask God to help us. Ask God to help us. That we could hear what he has to say, that we could hear him speak into our hearts, and that we would move on this health reform, that God would tell us what to do. Amen? Let us pray. And dear Heavenly Father, we ask thee to be with us this day as we do this health rally. Dear Lord, teach us things that are going to make us better, that will make us reveal you to the world, that will make us strong physically, so that our brains will work appropriately, that we can reason with you, dear Lord, and that we can advance spiritually, that we could put down this thing called sin, that we could choose your way, which is the best way, because your word says pleasures forevermore at your right hand. You've got great plans for us. Help us, dear Lord, to reach out to you. Help us not to be tricked by this devil. Lord, we put everything in your hands because we're not the master. You are. We are here to do your work and your bidding. Thank you, dear Lord, for being with us. Thank you for your spirit. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I invite you to join hands up and down the rows and across the center aisle. We're going to sing our blessing to each other the way we traditionally close our service here at Glendale.
Thank you for celebrating 27 years with us. How's that make it more?
The Lord bless you.